इसके ऊपर।
Okay, good morning, everyone. It's 9 o'clock, so let's get started. I have talked to administration and have found indeed that I can require cameras and audio to be turned on. So I'm going to do that starting in lab this afternoon. So it's going to be a mandatory lab, mandatory video and audio turned on. If you do not have a webcam, send me an email and maybe we can work something out. Okay, so we left off at talking about simple linear regression. And I'm going to go back to the slides. Before we start, are there any questions? Okay. Let me share my screen here and go back to where we left off. These are from the lecture two notes. And we just talked about simple linear regression. We talked about what the learning objectives were. Those were being able to identify what the response variable y is, the covariate x, the parameters, which are beta zero, beta one, sigma squared. Being able to write out this linear regression model, including both lines of this code for simple linear regression. And then today we're going to talk about interpretation of this model, looking at model fits, and then looking at model assumptions. So let's finish off on what we were talking about before. We were talking about the elk data before, Yellowstone counts of elk between 2005 and 2019. Those data are shown here. We talked about residuals being the distance between the data point and this line. So if it's on the line, the residual equals zero. If it's above the line, it's going to be a positive residual. If it's below the line, it's going to be a negative residual. All right, so now that we have data, and we have a model that we've described, simple linear regression model, the task is to fit the model to the data. And that's where we're going to use R. And what R is going to do is tell us the best estimates for beta zero, beta one, and sigma squared. So how do we do that in R? This is what we're going to talk about in class today. So how do we estimate these parameters? Not in class, but in lab. So lab focuses on simple linear regression and looking at beta zero, beta one, and sigma squared. Yes, we can do it by hand. There's complicated equations to do that, but we're not going to focus on that. We're going to use this LM function in R. And LM stands for linear model. And what we do is in the arguments for linear model, we say y tilde x, and then it's going to give us the parameters for beta zero, beta one, and sigma squared. So here's a look at how we would do that for the elk data. Here's an example. We have all of those counts are what they were. This is 2005, 2006, 2007, all the way up to 2019. There are a couple of years of no data where the surveys weren't conducted, and those are represented by NA. R knows what to do with NA. So we can include those in there as well. We have our X data. And our X represents 2005 to 2019. But actually, we're going to subtract off 2005 units from those data. And why we'll do this is to help interpreting the intercept beta zero, because we want the beta zero to be not 2005 units away from x. We don't want x equal to zero to be at 2005. We want it to be actually at zero. All right. So this is it. This is the command to fit a linear regression model, lm y tilde x. We're going to store this as an object called SLM for simple linear regression models. And then we can do some things to this object, including look at the summary of what this object is. And when we actually look at the summary of SLM, that is going to tell us what those parameter estimates are, among a lot of other things. Okay, any questions on this so far? And I can, no chat, okay. I'll move on then. So we'll see quite a bit of this in lab today and Wednesday. SLM, when we look at the summary of SLM, it's going to tell us what these are, but finding out what these are, you kind of have to know some of the R terminology within there. So it's going to call the beta zero is going to be called the intercept. Beta one is going to be called X, and then the residual standard error is going to equal sigma. And note that this is sigma and not sigma squared. So if we want the variance, we're going to have to take whatever it gives us here and square it. Let's take a look at these values for the elk data. Let's see, do I have the actual output? No, I saved that for lab. Okay. In our R output, when we fit the model, beta zero actually equals 5,067.56. That's our estimate for beta zero after we fit the model. After we run this command right here, these two commands, it's going to tell us beta zero, beta one, and sigma. And from the elk data, using these, we get an estimate of beta that is 5,767, an estimate of beta one as 40.13, and an estimate of sigma equal to 1304. So let me just pull up an R console and run these commands and show how we do that. I'm just going to copy and paste what's on the slides into RStudio and show what that output looks like exactly. So first I'm going to enter the data. I have the data all stored on the slide. And I'll put it right into the console. Actually, I'll make a script up here, make a new R script, copy and paste this Y equals information. I'll execute that command by pushing control return. Y is now stored as an object here. We have our data. We can print that out. I'm going to copy the X equals 2005. And now I'll look at X. And we see we have X equal to zero up to 14, where zero corresponds with 2005. One corresponds with 2006 and so on. We just have to keep track of that. And the reason why we do that is when we want to plot this, let's say we plot X and Y, we can see that the intercept is going to be right next to the data here. So the intercept where X equals zero is going to be right next to the data. What if we had said X equals 2005 to 2019? And then we plot X and Y. Well, it's going to look very similar, except now the intercept is nowhere to be found. It's way off to the left of the screen somewhere. It starts, what we see, the data first show up is 2006. The intercept is way over 2005 units away. And when we're trying to estimate what that intercept is, it's going to correspond to that point 2005 units away. So we want to set that first year at our first year of data. So that's why we just do this minus 2005 here. So let me actually copy this into the console. And then I'll do simple linear regression, SL, or simple linear model equals LM Y tilde X. It stores that model fit in the object called SLM, and I can do summary SLM and see what that output looks like. Now, as I mentioned in our slide, it calls beta zero the intercept. I forgot to change X to this value here. See, now when I didn't change, this is another reason why we subtract off 2005. Had I not changed it and subtracted off this 2005 here, because the X equals zero intercept is so far away, that value doesn't really mean a lot. 86,225 elk, the year zero BC. So in terms of this interpretation, if Jesus Christ is walking around, there's 86,000 elk in Yellowstone. By subtracting off that 2005, we get it more to current times. Okay, now I reran this code, so X equals 2005 to 2019. I fit the model with those revisions, and I looked at the summary of SLM, and I see the R output shown here. It tells us what the model is. It tells us all about the residuals. What this is a five-number summary of our epsilons. So we talked about our epsilons, and those are the distance from the data to the fitted line. And this gives a five-number summary, including the minimum value, the maximum value, the median value of our residuals, and the 25% quartiles and 75% quartiles. So we could do a box plot of these to look at our residuals. The real important numbers here are beta zero is indicated by this intercept, beta one is indicated by this X, and sigma is this residual standard error here. So 1,304 is our value for sigma. If we want sigma squared, we got to square that value. We would do, to square that in R, we do 304 with a little caret and a 2. So it's 1,304 to the second power. And that's our estimate of variance. Now we're going to talk about interpretation today. And interpreting the standard error, 1,304, is easier to interpret than the variance, 1.7 million. So in terms of interpretation, we're going to focus on the standard deviation instead of the variance. All right, let's go back to our slides. Before I do that, are there any questions?
Harry, would you mind letting Jevin in from the waiting room?
Yeah, and I just first hearing someone. Then, okay, let me get some volume here. There we go. Okay. All right. So everyone's admitted now. We're reviewing our lecture three slides from before. We're talking about fitting our models in R and how to extract the output from R and R Studio so we can interpret the statistical analysis of our data. All right. If there are no other questions, I'll go back to our slide. We see that where I got these values here from the R output, their intercept equals beta zero and X equals beta one, and residual standard error equals the sigma. All right, now, there are two questions that I'll ask about in homework assignments, practice problems, and exams. And those will be something along the lines of write out the general model statement and the fitted model statement. The general model statement is the same model that can be applied to any data analysis that we do. And the fitted model statement has to do specifically when we actually run the model and the data. So for simple linear regression, this is the general linear, this is a general model statement. And I'm going to go back a couple slides in a second to talk about three different ways of writing this. But when we specifically apply simple linear regression to the elk data and we estimate what those parameters are, then we include in there the estimated parameters. So this is our fitted model statement for the elk data. We have beta zero, our intercept equals 5,767.6. Beta zero equals negative 40.13. We still keep our X covariate for year in there. And then we include our standard deviation sigma and sigma squared, and we square that value to make sure we're talking about, to let people know we're talking about sigma equals 1304, not sigma squared equals 1304. We have to square this to get sigma squared. Okay, let me take a step back here and talk about writing out general model statements. There are three equivalent ways to do that. The way we've talked about so far in this lecture is writing out both a combination of the first one and the second one. We say our data, yi, equals our mathematical function, beta zero plus beta one xi, plus our residuals. And that our residuals have this assumption that they come from a normal distribution with a mean equal to zero and a variance equal to sigma squared. So that's one way to write out the general model statement. The next way is to just rearrange a couple things. Instead of writing out the mathematical function in terms of beta zero plus beta one xi, we are going to substitute beta zero plus beta one xi and write out mu I here. Write out mu I, have a visitor. Okay, and so we're gonna write out mu I equals beta zero plus beta one xi. And then just say yi equals mu I plus epsilon I, and epsilon I still comes from this normal distribution with mean zero and sigma squared. The other way and the shortest way is to put this all together and say our data yi come from a normal distribution with mean described by this function here, beta zero plus beta one xi, and variance sigma squared. So this is the most compact way to write this. This is the most explicit way to write this, where we write out all of these sections. And this is kind of a combination of the two. You can choose whatever way you want, but you have to be able to recognize these are all general statements for the same exact model. Sometimes it's useful to write out the first way, the second way, or the third way, depending on the context or exactly what we're trying to do. So there are a lot of ways to write out simple linear regression equation, and they all are equivalent. And you need to be able to recognize all of them. Any questions about this? Okay. So let's go back to our general model statement. Here we see this is the third way we wrote out our model. We can write the fitted model statement in the terms of this third way by just inserting the estimates of the parameters in the model. And what does this actually look like? Okay, well, this expression right here represents the equation of a line. We have mu equals beta zero plus beta one, and beta one is negative, times xi. That's this line right here. This line is also called mu. This is what we've been calling mu in the past. And the definition of this line here is the expected elk count for the year that we observed. So this is what our model says is the mean. And then this 1304 describes how much spread the data has from this line. If this value 1304 was small, we would see these points actually being much closer to the line. But it's pretty large. It's over a fifth of what the actual counts are. So we see these points spread around that expected value. So this salmon line here is mu. The points on the x-axis are the y's given whatever year they were taken, whatever year they were collected, which is represented by the x-axis. To calculate what mu is for any given year, we can plug in the equivalent, the year equivalent of xi, figure out what this equation is, and that'll put us right on the line. And that's what the expected value of that year is for our counts. So we've combined a mathematical model to describe the expected counts, this part here, with a statistical model, the normal distribution, that describes uncertainty in our observations using this variance standard deviation parameter. And uncertainty around this line, we're going to talk about more about this today, interpreting this, and how we would actually calculate that. We're going to calculate confidence intervals for the expected value. The actual equations for calculating those confidence intervals can look pretty intimidating. So to calculate the standard error, we have this equation here that's a product of two square roots. It includes a bunch of functions. We're not going to focus too much on this, but just to know that we can do it, and it exists. And if we do talk about creating, calculating the standard error, it's going to be in relation to writing an R function that'll do this for us. Okay. One thing to note about this fairly complex looking equation is that standard error will get larger as the value of x gets further away from the mean value of x. So remember, x's represent the years between from zero to however many years of data there are, something like 14 years of data, because it's 2019 minus 2005. I think that's 15 actually years of data. So x represents 0 to 14. X bar is just the mean of that. So as the x gets further away from the mean right here, this number is going to get larger. And because this is in the numerator of this equation, the whole thing is going to get larger. So the standard error is going to get larger. And we can see that in our next slide here. This represents 95% confidence intervals around this mean function of where we think the true value of elk, the true expected value of elk counts are given our data. So here we have our expected value of elk counts for each year and our 95% confidence intervals, assuming our model that we're using, described by these dashed lines. We're going to talk a little bit more about uncertainty as we get into lecture three. But these lines here were calculated using this function here, combined with a specific t value, which tells us which level of confidence we want. If we want 95% confidence, this is right around, well, it's bigger than 1.96. 1.96 would be if we want 95% confidence for if we assumed a normal distribution. Okay. Next question, is this a good model for the elk data? And let's open this up to some criticism. We can see the data shown here and we can see the model here. We'll talk about interpretation as we switch lectures here, but it looks like the population is declining through time. The expected population through time is negative. So the elk population is decreasing if we assume the model that we used. So do we think this simple linear regression is a good model? We haven't talked about assumptions yet, but what jumps out to you based on this plot? So let's have a discussion about that.
Is it all right if I jump in?
Please jump in. Yeah, that's awesome.
Okay. I don't think it's a good model. I think that I see the population declining up until about 2012, and then it seems to be very solidly increasing afterwards. So I just don't think that linear regression is appropriate for the data.
Yeah, that's a great comment. It doesn't look like a single line captures what's happening with these data here. It might be better if we had maybe a single line going down this way and then another line following these data. If we did that, we might be able to make it so these confidence intervals aren't so huge that they have to capture all of this information. So it looks like there's two trends in the data, one going this way and one going this way. And we're going to talk about multiple linear regression next and how we add some complexity to a straight line. So we're going to build on the simple linear regression model to talk about more than one covariate and how we can add realism or complexity to the simple linear regression model. Again, the simple linear regression model is the basic building block for the complexity that we're going to add as we continue to discuss how to add realism to our data analysis. Any other comments on this? There's some other things that stick out.
It's a 95% confidence interval, but almost half of the data is outside of that.
Yeah, right. That's a good point. We'll touch on that. We'll touch exactly on that point in the next slides. So 95% confidence intervals, rule of thumb, should cover about 95% of the data, even though there's some nuances in the interpretation there. But as a general rule of thumb, if we have 20 data points, 19 of them should fall within our 95% confidence intervals. And we can see here we have 14 and about four of them fall outside those points. Any other comments? One thing that we haven't talked about yet are the assumptions of simple linear regression model. And one of those assumptions are independence of observations, meaning one observation doesn't depend on where the previous observation is, for example. And if we look at these data, it looks like the first four points fall above the line, the next five points fall below the line, and then the last two points are above the line. So it seems like this point here kind of depends on where this point is. Likewise, this point kind of depends on where this one is. And they have that autocorrelation through time. So these ones are all kind of grouped together. These ones are all kind of grouped together, and these ones are grouped together. And that's something called the independence assumption that appears to be violated. And we'll talk about that next. All right, so that concludes the first lecture on simple linear regression. Any questions before I switch to our next lecture? Okay. So we're going to continue off the theme of simple linear regression, and we're going to actually talk about how we interpret these parameters and how we evaluate model fit. So after we know what the parameters are, the covariates, the residuals, the response variable, the predictor variable, all of those things we've already described in the first lecture. Now we're going to work on interpreting model output for the data and asking the same question that I just asked, is this actually a good model for the data? We're going to continue using this example that we talked about, the Yellowstone elk data. And here are those data again. We have the Excel table shown here on the left, and then the plotted data here with their actual natural X values, the years shown on the X axis. We talked about fitting this model to the data. Here is our fitted model statement for the data. We talked about this already. This is what this model looks like graphically. And here's what we're going to cover in this lecture and the learning outcomes specifically related to this part of the lecture. So in this lecture, you will be you will need to be able to interpret the parameters, beta 0, beta 1, sigma squared, and what those mean in terms of after we fit the model, what does it mean about the elk population? We're going to need to do this for both continuous data, which is similar to the elk data, but also categorical data. And we'll talk about categorical data more in lab today and on Wednesday. And actually, simple linear regression is directly analogous to doing a t-test. So you may have heard about t-tests in an introductory stats course. Well, a simple linear regression with two categories is identical to a t-test. We don't even need to teach t-tests anymore. All we need to do is teach simple linear regression for categorical data. Same thing with ANOVAs. A t-test and ANOVA are just specific cases of simple and multiple linear regression with categorical data. Okay. We want to know whether an effect is different than zero and how this is related to what you may have heard of called statistical significance. And then lastly, we want to examine the assumptions of simple linear regression and understand why meeting the assumptions are important for making inference about our wildlife population. So let's start off with the first learning objective and model interpretation. Let's work through these parameters we talked about and interpret what these parameters mean specifically. I have already showed this analysis in R. It's four lines of code. All we have to do is describe what our Y data are, what our X data are. We use the LM function, Y tilde X, and store that as the object SLR. And then we can do the summary command of SLR. And we get this output. We've seen this output already. In this example, I took off 2004 instead of 2005. It just slightly changes the interpretation on what year we're talking about when we describe the intercept. In this one, we're going to be talking about 2005 as the intercept year. All right. We have our estimate of beta 0, 5,807. We have our estimate of beta 1, negative 40.13. And then we have our estimate of sigma, not sigma squared. If we want sigma squared, we'd square this value. Those are the three numbers we're going to focus on. What do those values mean? So let's just go through those one at a time, beta 0, beta 1, and sigma, and describe how we interpret them both in general for all simple linear regression models, and then for the specific case of the elk population. So in general, for all simple linear regression, the definition of beta zero is the mean, also known as the expected value. I'll use those terms interchangeably, so be sure to know what I'm talking about for each of those values, of the response when X equals zero. So when we did this minus 2004, we said 2004 is going to be our X value after we transform it. When X equals zero, that's going to correspond to 2004. Yeah, and X equals one is going to correspond to 2005. So the general definition is the mean or expected value of this response when X equals zero. So this is what mu, what the value of mu is, or what the value of this line is here when X equals zero. Related to the context of the elk problem, beta zero is the expected value of the elk population when the year equals 2004. So if we want to know what the expected value of the elk population in 2004 is, we can just look at the intercept. From our analysis, we found that beta 0 equals 5,807 elk. Thus, the expected value of the elk population in 2004 was 5,807.69 elk. So this type of sentence here is what would be expected of you if you were asked, interpret the intercept related to the context of the question we're investigating. Don't forget the units. 5,807 what? Well, we're talking about the expected value of elk. All right, let's move on to beta one. In definition, beta one is the most general definition. It's the slope of that line, the slope of that line we were looking at. In terms of the statistical analysis, the general definition is the change in the expected value of y for one unit change in x. And the unit is going to depend on the problem we're looking at. So for specifically for the elk problem, the change in the expected value of the elk population per year is what beta one represents. After getting the results for beta one from our analysis, we can go on further to say that from our analysis, beta one equals -40.13. Thus, the expected value of the elk population is decreasing by 40.13 elk per year. Again, be sure to include the units on there. And then another way of saying this is the elk population has decreased an average of 40.13 elk per year between 2005 and 2019. That's kind of the summary you would give to, for example, a newspaper outlet who's interested on reporting what the elk population in elk, what the elk population in Yellowstone are doing. Now, the caveat to this last statement and giving this report to a newspaper outlet is we want to be sure we have a good model for our data. And we've already talked about why simple linear regression may not necessarily be a good model for these data. So before going on and reporting these results to anybody who might just look at the values and take something away from them, we want to be sure we do our due diligence and go through our model checking routines. And that's what we're going to do as the last segment in this lecture, to make sure we actually have a good model, because we don't want to make these statements until we know we have a good model for the population. And we kind of already know that we don't necessarily have that. But that doesn't change what these values actually mean in terms of simple linear regression, or what we would say about them if we use the simple linear regression model. And then this last segment is related to if we should use a simple linear regression model for these data. And we've already found that the answer is probably maybe not. All right, how about sigma squared? Sigma squared has a more obscure meaning than beta zero and beta one. In general, we can kind of describe it as the spread of the data around the expected value. I ask here kind of rhetorically, what are the units? And it's rhetorical because it's not necessarily an easy definition. It depends on the equation we use to calculate what the variance is. So the variance does not have a natural interpretation regarding elk units, but the standard deviation is easier to conceptualize than the variance, because the standard deviation is standardized. So it's relatively the same idea for each example that each data set that we're going to use this model on. We can go between the variance, sigma squared, and the standard deviation, sigma, by just taking the square root taking the square root of sigma squared. Now, this goes back to Becky's comment earlier, where she was saying that about 95% of the data were not within 95% confidence interval. But as a general rule of thumb, 68% of the data should be within one standard deviation of that line that we drew, that mu line we drew. 95% of the data should be within two standard deviations, and about 99% of the data should be within three standard deviations. And I have a visual to describe this on the next slide. The reason why sigma squared is more difficult to interpret and describe what are the units are is it depends on the sample size. The larger sample you have, the bigger the variance is going to get. Is that correct? I'm going to retract that statement and just move on. I think mean squared error is standardized by sample size. Okay, scratch that statement. But anyway, let's think about sigma and how we can kind of conceptualize what this actual value of sigma means. Here we have our fitted model for Yellowstone elk data. This is our mu line here, our expected value for each year. The salmon-colored confidence intervals represents one standard deviation, one standard error away from the mean. So if this were a good model, if this was a good model, we would expect about 68% of our points to be within these two confidence intervals here, between the lower salmon-colored one and the upper salmon-colored one. We see that about only one, two, three of them are within here, 3 out of 14. The light blue line represents two standard deviations or two standard errors away from the mean. And then, so about 95% of our data should be within two standard errors of this line. And that is demonstrated by everywhere within these two light blue lines here. So below the upper light blue line and above the lower light blue line. And then lastly, the blue line right here represents three standard errors away from the mean. There is a subtle distinction between standard deviation and standard error that you spend a lot of time thinking about in an introductory stats class. And that is an important distinction. I'm going to ignore some of those details here, and we'll touch on that more later. So right now I'm kind of sweeping those details under the rug just to work on conceptualizing what sigma actually means. So we can kind of visualize it here. If sigma is huge, the points are going to be pretty far away from the line. If sigma is small, they'll be very tight to the line. Any questions on that? All right, let's move on then. Now this is, these are the actual elk data. And from these data, we estimated what this sigma was. It was 1,304. But what if we had in a parallel universe, a different Yellowstone elk count, and the data actually looked like this? Well, if this is what the data actually looked like, the resulting estimate for sigma is 100. So we can kind of get a feel for what shrinking the value of sigma does to the data. They just get closer to that line. And we'll talk about this in lab today too. When we're simulating data, if we change the value of sigma, what do the resulting data that we're simulating look like? So the smaller the value of sigma, the tighter these points are to the line, the larger the value of sigma, the further away they are. And remember, we're estimating what sigma is from our data. We're first estimating what the line is, then we estimate what the value of sigma is, just to get an idea of how spread out those points are from the line. Okay, effect size and significance. This is our second learning objective. What does it mean when we have a big beta 0, big beta 1 versus a small beta 1? And can we say something about the population if it's really increasing or decreasing given the uncertainty in our model? So the question is, given our model fit to these data, is the population really decreasing, or is it just that our data are not precise enough to detect what the trend truly is, if the trend is different than 0? So how do we look at that question? Is the population really decreasing? The key to that question lies in some additional output in our R analysis. We don't have to do any more steps to fit our model. All we have to do is consider how much variation there are in our estimates of our slope and our slope here in our intercept. Now notice our slope here is negative 40. That's the estimate of our beta 1. And that's what we use to say the population appears to be decreasing. However, the standard error on that estimate is more than twice what the actual slope is. Now think about what that means. If we add two standard deviations to negative 40, both positive and negative, so that would be negative 209, let's see, if we multiply this by 2, that gives us about 210. Now we want to add 210 to negative 40, and we want to subtract 210 to negative 40. That's somewhere around 150 and negative 350, negative 250, right, on the positive and negative side. That value overlaps 0 by a lot. If our beta 1 value equaled 0, that says the population, the slope is 0, and the population is staying exactly the same. So it's a flat line if our slope equals 0. So if this negative 40 equals 0, then it's saying the population is not changing. If it equals a positive number, it's saying the population is increasing. Well, if we consider the uncertainty around this estimate, that includes a lot of positive numbers and a lot of negative numbers. So we don't really know if the population is increasing or decreasing when after we consider the uncertainty in our estimate. Let's take a look at this in simulation to try and make this idea a little more concrete. We'll also notice here standard error is 879 for the slope, for the intercept. So here's a simulation we can do to kind of look at the uncertainty in that trend line that we drew. We drew that negative slope that described mu in our plots to the data, that salmon line, the slope that described the expected value. But what happens if we appropriately account for uncertainty in that? And we're going to talk about using this R norm function in lab today and Wednesday. But this is a way we can kind of consider the uncertainty around that trend line. So we know the mean for beta 0 is 5,807. That's what our results told us. We also know the standard deviation is about 879. We know the mean for our slope parameter is negative 40, and we know the standard deviation is 105. Well, we can simulate values for beta 0 and beta 1 that contain that uncertainty here, and then plot what the line of that looks like. And we can do that 100 times. So this represents kind of a 95% confidence interval. So let's execute this. I already executed this in R, but we can execute this. And we're going to plot this 100 different times to see what those slopes would be like if we're thinking about 95% confidence intervals. And when we simulate those random intercepts and random slopes with those specific means and standard deviations, these are the expected values we get. The take-home point in here is, after we incorporate the uncertainty in our parameter estimates, some of these slopes are increasing, some of them are decreasing, and some of them are pretty flat. So if we think honestly about our analysis and what it tells us about the population, even though the point estimate was negative 40 for the slope and how many elk are decreasing every year, there's a lot of uncertainty around that point estimate described by the standard error, described by this 105.53, that we don't really know if the slope is positive or negative. So we can't really say a lot about what the elk population is doing in terms of trend with this model and these data. Population could be increasing, it could be decreasing. If we had to take a best guess at what it was doing, that would be our negative 40.13, but there's a ton of uncertainty around that negative 40.13. So to go and say to a news outlet that the Yellowstone elk population has been decreasing without further qualifying that statement by the amount of uncertainty would not be good practice. It could lead you into trouble. Now, what would it actually look like if we had less uncertainty around those data? Say, for example, if beta 1 equaled negative 60, this should be a negative 60, and the standard error of beta 1 equaled 100, and we do that same simulation, this is what we see. And now we see a clear downward trend here. So given our estimate of negative 60, and the standard error that we get from our data fitting the model, we can say, well, no, it actually looks like the population is decreasing. And we can say that with some certainty. However, using the data we collected, we did not get these results and we can't make those statements. This is what we see using the data we actually collected. All right, I'm out of time, so I'll leave model checking to next lecture. Till Wednesday, I'll cover up the last five slides. It looks like I'm getting through about 16, 17 slides here on average. But I'll cover this on next on Wednesday and leave the remaining, and then we'll start lecture 4. Again, starting in lab, camera and microphones will be mandatory. We won't have lab on Labor Day, but we will have lab on the Wednesday following that. So what's going to happen is before Monday labs were the first one to see the material, Wednesday labs were the second one to see the material because it's the same material taught both times. Now it's just going to flip. Wednesday will be the first people to see the lab and then Monday will be the second people to see the lab. All right, any questions? I'll stick around on here until office hours at 10 and then I'll stay in office hours for as long as anybody needs. And then sign off after that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Harry.
Hi.
Hi, for turning in our labs, do we email them to Julia?
Yep.
Okay, awesome. Yep. Thank you. Just checking.
Yep. Yeah, you're welcome.
Hello.
Hi, Brielle. Yep.
I had a quick question. So I ran into a snag on one of the problems in the lab. It worked, but what happened was that it condensed my numbers down to just one digit for some reason, and I couldn't figure out how to fix that.
Do you want to share your? You already did. Yeah. Okay. Do you want to share your screen? Let me.
Sure. Let's bring that up. You have disabled participant screen sharing.
Try again. I just changed it.
All right. This is weird. That was the vector. Da, 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 da. Yeah, so it was for this one. Control. So you see, I actually do get a long string of numbers, and then it gets condensed down into this. And so when I run the actual matrix, it comes out with the strings of zeros and ones instead of the as I scroll up, instead of these numbers.
Okay, so run that command on, go up a little bit. Starting when interacting with R code, it's almost necessary to start and just go line by line. Okay. Following R code is one of the more. So if you go up to just a little bit more, like line 70.
So they're at the beginning.
Okay, 69. Yeah, right there. So you're creating a matrix of 100 by 1. Yep. Go ahead and do that. Those aren't going to be all ones.
Yep.
So rule one, go ahead, run that. Now run the next one, our norm 100. That's sampling from normal distribution, mean 0, variance 1.
Yep.
Yep. Rule 2.m is a matrix. Okay.
So basically I kind of created three one-row column matrices and combined them all together.
Okay, so you got rule 3. Yep. Yep. Gotcha. Okay, now you're combining rule 1.
And does that sometimes too.
That, let's see, matrix.
So
that's what you want, right, so far?
Yeah, the thing was that, sorry, I'm scrolling up. Where's rule 3? Yeah, so that's what it gives me, is a string of zeros and ones. And sometimes it gives me more numbers, which was what was confusing me. Sometimes it could be like 1.001, and it shortened it down.
Oh, you mean it like cuts off the decimals?
Yeah, I mean, the decimals are kind of far back. They kind of be like 1.001 or 0.001 something. So it kind of rounds them to zeros and ones.
That is weird. So finish, do your answers and see if that all rules. Okay, so that looks okay to me.
Okay.
Wait a second. What was the first column? What was that supposed to be? Was that supposed to be all ones?
Yes, that was supposed to
be. That was supposed to be all ones.
All ones, R norm, and then R binomial.
Yeah, so that looks good.
Okay.
So I think everything you did up to that point is correct. At least the way it came out on the screen here. Now, you may have seen some other issues previous.
No, it was just confusing me why the decimals seemed to compact together when they didn't for the other one. It also kind of...
Oh, you mean in the third column, why there's no decimals?
Yeah, why...
What do you mean by compact?
Oh, it basically just means that it rounded it to one or zero. Sorry.
Okay. My part. So the question is, how come there's decimals in column 2, but no decimals in column 1?
Pretty much.
I think that has to do with the options that are set up in R.
Okay.
So one thing you can do is type in your console down on the bottom left. This may or may not change it. Options, parentheses, digits, digits, equals, let's say just 3 and see what happens. Let's see if that automatically, now if you run rule 3, or actually, that would work. Or all of your, okay. So what it's doing is it says, R is saying, it's first checking if it's an integer or a real number.
Mm-hmm.
And if it's a real number, it's going to print off your decimals. But if it's an integer, it's just going to give you that integer. So it's some built-in functionality in R that can identify whether or not it's an integer or not. Type out, now we just did this digits equals 3. Type out your second column of that matrix and see if that changed the digits from more than 3. It looks like there's about 10 of them there to just 3.
Feels my bonus type there. 2. No, that's not 3.
You can go, let me just Google. This is what I do when I have a question. I say changing the digits in R output. And that command that I gave you is, I'm fairly certain that'll come up, but R changing the number of digits displayed. And it says formatting decimal places, okay. Yeah, it says, I mean, options digits equal 2.
Hmm.
Let's see, the use of has been suggested as a possible answer. Is there a way to specify this within script runtime use? Okay, so you can round it, round your answer. I'll share my screen here. Okay, so this is what I had, this is the solution that I had said, but it's, sometimes it looks like it didn't totally work for your case. Another way to do it would be to use this round, and then X here is, I don't remember what you called it, but it was the second column of your matrix. And then you just specify how many digits you want, and that would do it. And you might be able to do that. Actually, I'm pretty sure that would work for your integers too, your zeros and ones, if you wanted to report integers. But for the lab exercise, if it's an integer, you do not need to report decimals.
Okay. Thank you. I'm sorry. I've got another class going on in about a minute.
Okay. Sounds good.
If I have other questions, can I ask you later? I was curious about the bonus.
Go ahead.
So I was curious about the bonus for question one because I didn't quite get it. And my class is during office hours, so I can't quite meet you during them.
Okay. If you want, we can talk during this week's swamped, but we could talk during, when's your lab? Do you have lab on Monday or Wednesday?
I have lab Monday. Can I talk to you about it after lab maybe?
You can talk to me after lab, yep. And then, let's see, Julie's not on right now, but you can submit the bonus after lab, after we talk, and just say, just tell Julie that I said it was okay that you submit the extra credit because you couldn't meet during office hours. So we discussed after lab. And then she'll check with me and I'll say, yeah, that's what I said. And it'll be good.
Okay. Thank you. I've got to go.
Okay.
Have a good day.
Thanks. You too. All right. So I have office hours now and I'll stick around as long as it takes. You guys have any questions?
I was wondering if we can work through number four on the lab from last week.
Sure. Okay, let me pull that up. All right, so let's see, lab one, here we are. I'm just gonna jump down to, number four. All right, create a 100x3 matrix called x.m that meets the following conditions. The first column is all ones. The second column contains samples from a normal distribution with mean equals zero. Standard deviation equal to 1. The third column contains samples from the binomial distribution with probability of success equal 0.5. Are there any specific parts of this question that you got hung up on?
I think I got part one right, where like the first column is all ones, and I think I got it set up to where it's a 100x3 matrix.
Okay.
But getting the second column to contain samples from the normal distribution. So it's like the second and third part, I think I'm having.
Okay, two and three. And was the challenge with that subsetting the matrix or actually just sampling from that distribution?
I think it's just a little bit of both.
Okay, all right, let's work through that now that I have a clear idea of what the issue is. So you got the first part. Did I give it a name here? Let's call it x.m, I guess. We'll say this equals a matrix. At first, I'll just put all NAs in the matrix. If you just put one value in the first spot, it'll put that same value everywhere. So I could put NA or 29 or 92 or whatever in there. Let's just start off with NAs, and it'll fill the matrix with all of those values. And we said 100 by 3, so that's 100 rows and 3 columns. All right, so I'm going to run this, and then we'll take a look at this. Okay, so I just created this 100 by 3 matrix. And as I mentioned, if you just put one value here, it's going to stick that value everywhere in that matrix. So if I change this to 29, then it's, and then I look at what that matrix is, it's going to be 29s everywhere, right?
Yeah.
Now, we have to do two things here for part two. We have to first figure out how to put something in the second column. And the second part of that question is, we want the something that we want to put there has to come from this distribution that I described. So let's deal with that first part. That how do we put something in the second column of a matrix? Well, we've already created our matrix X dot M. And we know we can subset matrices by specifying what row and what column we want if we use these brackets here. So this is how I'm going to subset the matrix. In the subset of this matrix I want, I can put whatever columns, whatever rows I want here, and whatever columns I want here. But it says the second column, and to do the second column, we put a 2 right here. So this is going to give us the second column of that matrix. That's the first part. That's how we subset it. Okay. The second part is, what do we put in there? How we put that in there, I just take this function and stick it in like that. So this function is going to generate 100 samples from a normal distribution with mean equal to 0 and standard deviation equal to 1. I could write out here mean equals 0, standard deviation equals 1. The reason there's nothing in here now, why it's blank, why it doesn't have a mean and standard deviation, is because there's a default mean and a default standard deviation, and that default is 0 for the mean and 1 for the standard deviation. So this is going to give me the equivalent thing as this does. But I might as well put it in there just to be clear about what it is. So now this is going to say, well, give me the second column in this matrix and plug in these 100 values here. Okay, so that's 2. The third one, part 3, is essentially identical to part 2, except we change which column and we change what the function is. So do you have your R script pulled up?
Yeah.
Can you share your screen, and do you want to work through this? Is that okay with you?
Yeah.
Okay, let me make you a co-host here. Now you can share your screen. Okay.
So I just do like the X dot M again, but it wants the third column.
Yep.
So how do you do like the binomial? I know this is like R normal right here.
Mm-hmm.
Let me put a scroll up for that.
We haven't talked about that in this lecture. We talk about it in our next lab today, but the script is written in there. It's copied right in there. So similar to the R norm, it's there too. You can use that. Maybe we did talk about that. That's right. We talked about it at the very end. Yeah, if you look on line 46 at the end there, it's shown right there. Yeah, right there. You can copy and paste that whole thing in there, and then that'll do it for you.
Okay. And then it wants it to be these numbers right here.
Yeah, 100, the first one is how many samples. The second one is the size of the binomial distribution, which is 1. And the second one is the probability.
Okay, so just like this?
Yep. And that's it. Perfect. Now, a couple of lines of clarification. On lines 48 and 49 and 50, you're basically writing over what you've already done. Let's see. So 48, you create an object called x.m. Mm-hmm. 49, you create another object called x.m. So you're writing over the x.m you wrote on line 48.
Okay.
And then line 50, you're creating another object called x.m, and you're writing over what you created on line 49. So you can essentially, like
49 or 48.
Exactly. You can delete those. Yep.
Perfect. I haven't started number 5 yet, so I might need help with that too.
Okay. Sounds good. Well, I have office hours until 10. Let's see, we can, if you want to try and work through this now, we can too. Let me talk to Travis here. Take a minute to think about this.
Okay.
While I see if Travis has any questions.
I'll stop sharing.
Okay. Hey, Travis. I can't hear you yet. I can't hear you yet. Let's see, are you muted? There you go. Maybe. I still can't hear you. Now you're muted. Now you're unmuted.
Did that work?
Yep, there you go.
Oh, never mind, Daniel, I figured it out. So I am having problems with pretty much the whole thing except for the first question.
Okay. Let's go to number 2 then. Let me pull this up. And let me share my screen. All right, number 1, create the following matrix and store it as an object called foo.m. And that bonus question is really tricky. Okay. Number 2, create an object called bar.m that contains the 4 interior cells of foo.m. So let's go to your first question. I'm going to allow you to share your screen here. So when you're ready, you can share that and see what you have for that first one.
Okay. Oh. Now it's not responding.
Oh, maybe I have to stop sharing mine. Okay, try sharing yours.
Okay. I think my Zoom just froze.
Okay, I still hear you. I think you're maybe frozen now. I can see your old version. I can see your old version frozen there. But... Okay. Let me change here now. Make co-host. I can, well, it makes it more challenging for you to tell me trying what to write. Let's try sharing your screen one more time. If that doesn't work, if that doesn't work, then I can work through it with you. It makes it a little more challenging, but that's okay. We'll figure it out. So let me see if I can make, are you a co-host? I think you are now. So if you can share your screen, to do that, on the bottom, you go to share screen, and then it chooses a bunch of screens you can share, and then choose the one that has our studio.
Okay.
Okay. Do you see the share screen at the very bottom? There's a bunch of, sometimes these Zoom menus aren't huge.
I can see it, but then my R just stopped working.
Oh, your R stopped working. Okay.
So I have to reopen it.
All right, let's try that.
What is going on? Okay.
There we go. Okay.
Is this lab one?
I see lab one, parenthesis two. I see lab one, parenthesis one, lab one, parenthesis two. Lab one, parenthesis three. Okay, so maybe if you go over to lab one, parenthesis three, that might be your most recent one. And scroll to the very bottom. And I'm gonna stop.
Okay, yeah.